This was record, line 11 was forward and the sound like no line they brought.
Yes, there will be this.
Charlie Berkman.
State calls Officer Brent Phelan.
Raise your right hand if you swore, please.
You solemnly swear upon me to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Good afternoon, officer. Would you please state your name and spell it?
Officer Brent Phelan, P as in Paul, H-E-L-A-N.
All right. And Officer Phelan, where are you employed?
The Brentwood Police Department.
And were you employed at the Brentwood Police Department on April 17, 2018?
Yes, sir.
And what is your position at the Brentwood Police Department?
At that time and currently, I'm a member of the department's directed enforcement team, which is primarily responsible for traffic enforcement, crash, and traffic homicide investigations.
Okay. On April 17, 2018, did you receive a call to respond to a potential stolen vehicle involving the BMW dealership?
Yes.
And is the BMW dealership located at 1568 Mallory Lane?
Yes.
And what did you do once you received the call?
So it had been put out that the vehicle that was stolen from the BMW dealership had been followed by a third party to the area of Concord Road and Jones Parkway, which was where I was at the time on routine patrol. I was traveling westbound and observed a vehicle matching the description, which was given was a gray BMW X6 SUV. I observed a vehicle matching that description traveling eastbound on Concord Road, at which time I made a U-turn and entered traffic behind the vehicle. I had to maneuver around another citizen vehicle uninvolved to get directly behind the BMW. At the time I did that, I observed that the vehicle was not displaying a license plate, which was also consistent with the description provided by BMW. At that time, due to being in an unmarked unit, I stayed behind the vehicle to wait for other officers to respond to the area. Once I observed Officer Caleb Andrist running up the center turn lane in a marked unit, I activated my emergency lights at that point and attempted to initiate a traffic stop.
Did you also attempt to put on your sirens?
Yes, sir. So after I initiated the emergency lights, the vehicle continued in the stop and go traffic flow for a few seconds. After that, I initiated my siren, and at the time that I activated my siren is when the X6 entered the center turn lane and began actively fleeing by overtaking traffic.
Was the center turn lane a lane in which traffic, a person would normally travel during in the flow of traffic like that?
No.
Okay. And you said that the driver was actively fleeing from you?
Correct. At this time, my lights and siren were activated. There was another Brentwood police vehicle behind me with lights and siren activated. As soon as we had cleared an initial block of traffic congestion, per department policy, at that point I yielded primary pursuit position to the marked unit that was behind me. and at which point the marked unit took over the primary position, which is directly behind the suspect vehicle, and then I followed as secondary unit to call the pursuit.
Okay, and did the marked unit have on its license sirens?
Yes.
Okay. And about how long did you travel behind the driver of this BMW X6?
The pursuit was initiated, if I remember, it was 5:51 p.m. and was terminated at 5:53 p.m. The distance traveled, pursuit was initiated in the area of Concord Road and Haverhill Drive and was terminated by the on-duty patrol supervisor in the area of Edmondson Pike.
And why was the pursuit terminated?
My understanding was that was because BMW was aware that we were made aware that the vehicle had active GPS tracking, and there was no longer a need to risk public safety by tracking the vehicle visually when it could be tracked passively.
And why was there a concern for public safety?
Because of the time of day and traffic congestion and rush hour.
Were there a number of cars on the road?
There was moderate to heavy traffic on the stretch of road.
Oh, were you able to observe the driver?
I did not observe the driver at the time I turned around. My primary focus at that point being in an unmarked unit, I was attempting to make a U-turn in traffic without using my blue lights, and not getting hit was kind of my priority, but I immediately recognized the vehicle as that was given by BMW.
I believe those are my questions. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Officer Phelan. Just a few questions. You said that you followed Mr. Reinking for 2 minutes, correct?
The pursuit actually lasted 2 minutes. It was at 5:48 p.m. was when the call was dispatched, or dispatch advised that he was in the area, and then the pursuit was initiated at 5:51 p.m. I was probably behind him for, I would say, approximately a minute or so prior to that, with no lights or anything on, just in an unmarked
car. In an unmarked car. So he would have no idea that you're a police officer until you turn your lights on, because you got an unmarked car, right?
Theoretically.
And when you say the word pursuit, you mean you turned your lights on and you followed him for about 2 minutes with your lights on, right?
And siren.
All right. And you said it was from somewhere on Concord Road to Edmondson Pike?
Correct. From Haverhill Drive to Edmondson Pike.
Okay. And about how far is that, roughly?
Say approximately mile and a half, 2 miles.
Okay. And I think in your report you noted that you when you follow behind him with your lights and everything on, y'all were going approximately 40 miles an hour, right?
The speed for the pursuit ranged between 40 and 50 miles an hour. They did not exceed 50.
For 2 minutes for about a mile and a half, but correct. 40 to 50 miles an hour. Okay. That's all.
Thank you. Now calls Caleb Andrist.
Your Honor, object under 403 is cumulative.
Your Honor, his testimony would be different.
So if you would raise your hand, each one, please.
You saw me start a bomb and tell the truth, the whole truth, and the truth, so help you out.
Caleb Andrist. Good afternoon, sir. Would you please state your name for the record?
Caleb Andrist.
And how do you spell your last name?
A-N-D-R-I-S-T.
And were you previously employed as a police officer at the Brentwood Police Department?
Yes, sir.
And were you employed as an officer on April 17, 2018?
Yes, sir.
On that date, did you respond to a call of a stolen vehicle involving the BMW dealership in Williamson County?
Yes.
And what did you do once you received the call?
I was kind of in the area where the call came out. The call was in the south part of town. I was in the southeast part of town. When the call came out, we were getting kind of delayed updates as far as the GPS goes to where the vehicle was headed. So as we were getting these updates, it said that the vehicle was going on 65. There's also a follower of that vehicle, and they followed it on a 65, and then it got onto Concord Road and was heading east, and that was kind of where I was. So I started heading west on Concord Road and intercepted the car on Concord.
When you say you intercepted the car, what do you mean?
We passed each other. We saw the vehicle going, I saw the vehicle going east on Concord. I was traveling west on Concord. So that's what I meant when I said intercept.
And what, were you driving a marked police unit?
I was, yes. I was in a marked patrol car.
And just to be clear, what does that mean?
That means lights, sirens, lettering. It is a plain marked police car.
That says police on the outside?
It says Brentwood Police on the side, yes.
Okay. And was it daytime or nighttime?
Daytime.
Okay. And when you intercepted the BMW that you were looking for, were you able to see who was inside the vehicle?
Yes.
Okay. And could you give me a description of the driver?
Yeah, he was a thin white male. I don't know a height because he was sitting down. But thin white male, blondish hair. But I just remember him looking at me and me looking at him as we passed each other.
The two of you made eye contact?
Yes, we did.
Okay. And what did you do after you passed him?
As soon as I passed him, I turned around to initiate a traffic stop.
Okay. And what do you mean by that?
Because we're going opposite directions, I had to make a U-turn on Concord Road. So when that happened, Officer Phelan, who was just up here testifying, was actually in front of me to start with, and he was in his unmarked patrol vehicle. And so I pulled a U-turn right behind him, and at that time, he initiated his traffic lights, or his overhead lights. I did the same, and also our sirens as well.
Once you put on your lights and sirens, what did the vehicle, the BMW, do, the driver do of the vehicle?
Initially, it looked, you could see him looking in the rearview mirror back. You could tell that you could see the vehicles, the patrol vehicles behind him, and he kind of just stopped in traffic. And then after a short time sitting in traffic, it was around rush hour, so there was a lot of traffic on Concord Road at the time. When he stopped in traffic for just a couple seconds, he actually went into the middle lane, the turn lane, and passed vehicles in the middle lane. That's when we got behind him and continued to try to pursue him and stop him.
Okay, and did he ever stop for you?
No.
And at some point in time, did you have to cut off the pursuit?
Yes. Based on traffic and the fact that there was GPS in the vehicle, at the time we didn't know anything other than the vehicle was stolen. There was GPS on the vehicle, so it was terminated shortly into the pursuit.
Okay. And after you terminated the pursuit, did you at some point in time continue your involvement with that investigation?
With the investigation, but not with the pursuit or anything like that.
Right. And so what did you do as part of the investigation afterwards?
Later on that evening, Metro Police called or contacted our department and said that they did locate the vehicle at an apartment complex. And so I went out to that apartment complex and dusted for fingerprints. I was a crime scene technician at the time. Dusted for prints on that vehicle.
And do you recall what part of town that apartment complex was in?
I believe it was in Antioch. I'm not real familiar with Davidson County. I did all my work in Brentwood.
Okay. Do you recall the address that it was located at?
I do not.
Would perhaps seeing your police report help refresh your recollection of it?
Yes.
And Mr. Andrews, have you been able to refresh your recollection as to the address that
Yes.
you recovered the vehicle from?
Yes.
And what was that?
5000 Mountain Springs Drive in Antioch.
Antioch, Tennessee?
Antioch, Tennessee, yes.
Okay. When you when you recovered the vehicle, you said you were dusting it for fingerprints and whatnot. Do you recall seeing any of the dealership paperwork that is usually on the window of one of the vehicles?
No, there's a process that we do. We start from top and work our way down. And if anything was on there, I would have noticed that because we wouldn't have been able to dust there because it would have obscured the fingerprints with the stickers and things like that.
Okay. And just, I guess the last question is, when you went to that apartment complex to recover the vehicle, was it nighttime?
Yes, it was dark outside.
Okay, those are my questions.
Officer, you said that the pursuit was short. Did you stop the pursuit at the same time that Officer Phelan did?
We did, yes. It came over the radio. Our sergeant terminated the pursuit, and we stopped at the same time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Officer.
Thank you.
Your Honor, the station next witness would be the video deposition of Jena Jacobsen.
Mm-hmm. Hey, jury, the state's about to replay a video deposition. The deposition is a testimony given under oath outside of court. I don't know what it may have been for, but outside of your presence, I don't know exactly the location of where the deposition was taken. But the point is that it was under oath, and you will evaluate the testimony of this witness and the credibility of this witness the same as you would have other witnesses who appeared in open court, sworn into, and testified in front of you. Did they get that thing working again?
Yes, sir. I don't know.
Jena, J-E-N-A, last name Jacobsen, J-A-C-O-E-S-E-N.
Ms. Jacobsen, do you recall an incident that occurred on April 17, 2018 at the BMW dealership?
Yes, sir.
Were you employed at that dealership?
Yes, I am.
You're still employed?
Yes, sir.
In April of 2018, what was your job?
I was a client advisor, which is a salesperson.
And where is the dealership?
It's located in Brentwood, off Mallory Lane.
In Tennessee?
Yes, sir.
On that day, did you happen to come in contact with the individual that was here?
Yes.
Could you please describe what time you came into contact?
Sure. Towards the end of my business day, so later in the afternoon, after 5, around before 6-ish.
And so what happened between 5 and 6 o'clock?
Sure. He came into the dealership directly to our front desk area and asked to see a vehicle.
Okay. And were you the person at the front desk at the time?
I was. Mm-hmm.
And then what did you
see? So I asked him what he was interested in. He gave me a description of the vehicle that he was looking to see, which was an X6. We had a few of them on the lot, I think two at the time. So we proceeded to walk out together to look at the vehicle.
So I guess just talk about as you're showing him the vehicle.
Sure. So we walked out together. He followed behind me. He was just quiet. We walked out, and I headed towards the vehicle so that we could do a demo and go over the vehicle and go over features and show him what he was looking for.
Okay. And could you describe the individual?
Sure. He was taller. Blonde, in jeans and a baseball tee, just an ordinary customer from the beginning, as far as looks go.
And so, once you get to the car, what is the interaction?
Yeah, so once we get out to the vehicle, my job as a salesperson is to demo that vehicle with the potential client, to go over the features, what they're looking for, ask them questions so that I can assess how best to help them. So once we got out to the vehicle, we did a short little walk around. We got in the vehicle together where I'm able to demonstrate some of those features to him. features like our GPS system and how things work. So we proceeded to sit in the car while I kind of went through a brief demo on the vehicle.
Did you ever have the car on, or is it the demonstration of the GPS and things like that?
Yes. So we do turn the vehicle on during the demonstration. It allows all the electronics in the vehicle to be turned on and accessed. Things like volume control for the radio station, the main center console screen becomes available, which will have weather, news, things like that on it that we can demonstrate to the customer.
As you are doing the demo, did you have to have the key?
Yes, so there is not an ignition for the key unless it's manually assessed. So it's a key fob. As long as you have the key fob, you can enter and exit the vehicle with the touch of the door handle. So as a salesperson, as long as I have the key to the vehicle, I can access that vehicle. And it's something that we keep with us either in our pocket or a side door panel, wherever we might keep it. We keep it during that demo, so it's in our possession. It's not until the customer opts to go for a test drive that we turn that key over and we go on the test drive with them. 9 times out of 10, the key is never in the customer's hands. It's always with us because we're in the vehicle during the demo.
And while we're doing, showing him the part of the car, telling him, showing the screen and how the bottom works, he is in the driver's seat.
He is in the driver's seat, passenger seat.
Was there anyone else with you?
No.
And so, what if anything is he saying to you?
Not much. It was a quiet interaction between me and the customer. He didn't give any information as to what he was looking for in a car. Most clients during that interaction are asking us questions, whether the car's all-wheel drive or what the GPS system is like. They're looking for certain features, and it was a very one-sided conversation. I was trying to pull any information I could from him to figure out what he was looking for in his vehicle.
And so he just wasn't getting the sheet back?
No.
At some point in time, did he ask to drive the vehicle?
He didn't ask to drive the vehicle. He stated he was going to drive the vehicle.
Okay, so it was more like, I'm going to take this car.
I'm going to drive the vehicle, yes.
Okay, and what was your response?
My response was to follow procedure, which at that point in time is to get a driver's license and an insurance card from our customers so that we're safe to go out the road for that test drive.
So did you think he was just asking?
Yes.
And so what did you actually take his driver's license?
No. When I made the comment, that's fine, I just need to get your driver's license and insurance, he said, I don't think you understand, I'm going to drive this vehicle.
Did, at some point in time, did he attempt to put the car in drive?
He did. The shifter that we have with BMW was a newer shifter at the time. It has a unlock feature on it. So you can't just push the shifter forward and go into a gear. You actually have to use an unlock button on that shifter. And he had tried to click the shifter into drive, but was not successful. And I explained to him about the button, and yeah.
Okay, and so he told you that you testified and said twice.
He proceeded to ask if I had the key, and at that point in time, I said, yes, I do have the key. Then I held the key up in my hand.
What did he do once you held the key?
At that point, he reached over and grabbed the end of the key and proceeded to pull that key from my possession.
Did you, he took it out of your hand?
Yes.
Did you put up any resistance to that?
Yes, I didn't let go right away. I was shocked that somebody was physically taking something from me. It had never happened to me before, so it wasn't something that I let go of right away. There was a pull.
After he physically took the key out of your hand, what did you do?
So as he took the key and I was pulled back towards him, I made direct eye contact with him and asked him if he was serious, and he proceeded to say yes, that I needed to get out. And at that point, I realized that the car was probably going to be taken from me, and it was in my best interest to let go of the key and to remove myself from the situation.
Once you got out of the car with the key, what did you see?
So when I got out of the car, I was agitated, so I slammed the door, stood there for a second, thinking, okay, like, this is happening to me. And he proceeded to put the car in drive and then proceeded to head in the wrong direction towards the back of my property.
That's the lot of the BMW dealership?
Correct. There are two entrances, well, technically there are three entrances, two to the main lot. And he proceeded to drive towards the back where there was not an exit.
Did he eventually leave the parking lot?
He did, yes.
Did you or anyone at your dealership contact the police?
Yes.
And how soon after checking the car did you?
Seconds. We did at the time use an anti-theft device on all of our vehicles that allowed an app on our phones to track the vehicles. So that app was used as an anti-theft device as well. It had a trigger system on it where if a vehicle was taken, you could press a button and it would trigger the system, letting the police department know that the vehicle was being stolen.
Did you discuss the app with this tracking device on the vehicle with him?
I did not. I discussed the GPS system, which going over navigation is standard in any demo. It's a strong feature for BMW. It's very intuitive and works quickly, so it's something that we typically will go over during the demo.
Okay. It wasn't part of your conversation that you could track that from your phone?
No.
Did you speak to the police and then?
Yes. They were there very quickly. I don't know an exact time, but they were there very efficiently.
Since this incident on April 17, 2018, have you seen any, have you learned the identity of the person who took the vehicle from you?
Yes.
And do you know who was that?
Travis Reinking. And voice, it was just a statement.
And was that his demeanor for the entirety of the interaction?
Yeah. Other than telling me that he was serious and I needed to get out, it was pretty level.
What do you mean other than?
That portion, I guess, to me felt more intense because we made direct eye contact, and he was very clear that I needed to get out of the vehicle.
And do you, since you work at BMW,
Yes.
You didn't have one with you?
Yes.
Would you be willing to demonstrate to me how the interaction occurred?
Sure.
I'm going to ask you to step down. This tag is about the same size as the tag that was on the key that took it. And so if I'm him, or I'm gonna be you holding the key. I want you to demonstrate how Mr. Reinking took the key.
Probably in the vehicle with them 8 to 10 minutes. I mean, not longer than a normal interaction, just because there was a lot of me talking and not him, but a normal time frame.
About 8 to 10 minutes in the car, and it's how long from the moment you walked in to the air to the time that he's gone altogether?
Maybe 15 minutes tops. Trying to remember back that far, but yeah.
A little bit less.
Correct.
Or maybe even a little more than that. So, as you're describing the features of the vehicle, was there ever any discussion about maybe him having the vehicle turned in or anything like that?
Yes.
Okay, could you tell me about that?
Sure. So it is a question that we would answer or ask any of our guests, and that is if they are planning on trading a vehicle in that day. It allows us to gather information from the customer to know whether or not they're serious in making a purchase at that point in time, and it also allows us to offer them an appraisal on that vehicle. that way we can start a process and see where they're at.
You asked him about trading, what did he say?
He said he didn't want to discuss it, that we would discuss it later, which was an odd response, but sometimes customers don't want to give you that information right away. They feel like it's better to wait, so we waited. I didn't pressure him on it. I was maybe pressuring the situation by asking him that question. He just did not want to answer that question. Correct.
Okay.
You interviewed the Brentwood Police Department later than that?
Yes.
And were you also, after that, sometime later, were you interviewed by a private investigator with the Law Director's office?
Yes.
And was that just a few weeks later after the incident?
I don't remember the exact time frame of that interview, but it was following you.
Do you recall it, whether it was days, weeks, months, years, any kind of recollections when it might have
been? It was a couple weeks from my recollection.
Okay. And the investigator, I think, interviewed you at the beach, is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay. And is it fair to say that the events, what took place on April 17, 2018, were still fresh in your mind at the time when you were with that investigator?
Yes.
And have you, are you aware that that interview was? Did you review that right before this deposition? And your answers that you gave to the investigator during that interview, were those based on your personal knowledge and personal observations which you heard on April 17th, 2018?
Yes.
So, it's my question. When did you first see this driver? Where was he when you first actually saw him?
At the dealership, right at the front desk.
Are you aware that prior to that he had walked onto the lot?
No, I was not. I was not aware of any of his behavior prior to my incident until after the fact.
Okay. Was there ever any vehicle, car, or motorcycle, bicycle, anything that was found on the lot that was related to Mr. Reinking, to your knowledge?
No, sir, not to my knowledge.
Was there any indication that
After the fact, I was made aware that he walked onto property. I do not know from where.
Okay. And do you know how long he had been on the property prior to meeting you?
I do not know a time frame. I know he was on property long enough to select a vehicle of choice, but that is all I know.
And did your understanding, was he with any other salesperson? So when you said select a vehicle of choice, was he with any other salesperson, or was he walking the lot by himself?
From my understanding, he was walking the lot by himself and selected that particular vehicle on his own prior to coming through the front door and asking to see it.
And then he came through the front door. Were you at the reception desk? Is that what it is?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. And your job then was a salesperson for BMW, correct?
Yes, sir.
That is correct. So I guess you have your normal interaction in trying to see if he might be interested in trying to sell him a vehicle. Is that fair?
Yes.
Okay. Then you said, I believe, that the two of you exited the dealership building and went into the lot. And then he has said that he wanted to look at a Model X6. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay. And you thought that was a little strange.
I did. He was taller in stature, and the X6 is a hatchback slope roofline SUV. It is one of the larger ones. It just isn't a vehicle that a lot of our customers ask for typically when they are of his height.
So in other words, with his size,
it wouldn't be a car I would recommend, but I have seen people of his height purchase the vehicle.
You suggested that he look at the X5 and he insists on the MX6, is that correct?
That is correct.
Prior to entering into the X6, can you estimate how long it was that you interacted with him from the time he walked into the building until
place was located a little bit out on the lot, so we had to walk out together, and that was the time that I spent with him.
Yeah. And so, basically, you know, a few minutes of conversation before you get into the vehicle, and I think you said, based on your recollection, that y'all were inside the vehicle together for approximately 8 to 9 minutes, or 8 to 10 minutes, just somewhere approximately like that.
Yes.
Okay. And I believe it's my understanding that you, that when you interacted with him, that you felt like something was off. Is that a fair statement?
Yes.
Okay. And that it was a, something that I think you described as an incredibly strange interaction. Is that how you described it before?
Yes.
And are you talking about when you're seated in the passenger seat and he's in the driver's seat and you're kind of trying to explain to him features, there's not really what you would call a normal back and forth conversation. Is that what you're referring to?
Yes, sir.
Okay. When you say that it was a strange interaction.
Yes, sir.
Something just didn't seem right.
There was no back and forth. So either he was just being an incredibly difficult client, or I was not talking about anything he was interested in, and I was trying to figure that out.
Okay. And while he was in the vehicle, was he trying to see what would work and kind of look at the dials and the buttons and the things like that? Was he kind of messing with the car to try to see what different things it is?
That's my recollection.
Dennis, we've heard about the interaction with the took the key from you and you got out of the vehicle with no contact. You were able to observe them when you put the car in drive, kind of observe the path that he took. Is that correct?
Yes.
And is it fair to say that he kind of took a path that would not be the normal path that you would take if you were trying to steal a vehicle? Is that fair?
Yes.
He kind of went to the opposite way of the exit? Is that fair?
That is correct.
And I think you used the term that it was almost like he was trapped in the back of the parking lot. Is that a fair statement?
There is no exit the way he went.
Right. And he was driving fairly slowly when he was in the parking lot. Is that correct?
Yeah.
And in fact, he had kind of gone to the back of the lot and then turned around and started coming towards the front of the lot. Is that fair to say? You were still out in the lot at that point in time. And so then eventually he got to the street and then pulled out onto the street.
Correct.
Is that correct? And you went inside the dealership building, correct?
That's right.
And I think you alerted your manager that it looks like a car's been stolen.
The car was stolen.
Okay, but that's what I'm saying.
Yes.
Okay, you alerted the manager that the car had been stolen.
Yes. Yes.
So, when you went into the dealership, you learned your manager that the car had been stolen. There were other people, the workers in the dealership, is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay. And at that point in time, I think one of them asked, was he on drugs? Like, kind of questioning, like, what would happen to you? Is that correct?
That is correct. Obviously, when I came in, and there are other employees and managers, and they were asking me obvious questions that you would ask, you know, were they inebriated, were they on drugs, did they have a weapon? They were just questioning what happened.
Right. And you would agree that his demeanor was off, something was strange about him. Do you agree with that?
Yes, sir.
Now, when you were asked the question, would you say the normal questions that somebody would ask, perhaps, if the car was stolen when it happened, did that make you think of something in your own personal life as an explanation as to what might explain the strange behavior?
Yes.
Okay. And is that you, at least at that time, you had a friend you had been friends with for about 7 years, had suffered from, there was a was paranoid schizophrenia. Is that correct?
That is correct. I don't know this friend's formal diagnosis, but I know that he had struggled with mental health issues.
Okay. But do you recall telling the investigator that you had a friend that suffered from, that was a paranoid schizophrenia or suffered from paranoia or schizophrenia?
Yes.
Okay. This friend that you had known at that time for a 7-year period, how often have you been around the friend?
Consistently.
Okay. So you were very familiar with the person's mental health issues?
Yes.
Were you familiar with that person's issues? Or how they, so with your friend, when your friend was medicated?
I was.
And were you able to observe that person's demeanor and the way they carried themselves?
obvious to me, in my opinion. He didn't seem inebriated or on drugs as far as what you would think. And I did make the statement that it was almost like he was off of them, like he just was off. This is the word that I was supposed to create. It was just off to me. The situation was off. I couldn't put a finger on it because there was no smell of alcohol, there were no indications of him being on drugs. So I think that is what I was reiterating to them.
Okay. And just finally, going back to the recording that you listened to right before the deposition, is that a recording of your entire interview with the public defender and an accurate interview with your interview with the investigator of the public defender?
I believe I heard it in the interview, yes.
Thank you very much.
Ms. Jacobsen, do you know if Mr. Reinking knew the layout of the parking lot such that he knew that if he, when he drove to the back, he couldn't exit that one?
I don't know if he knew the layout.
Okay. And you said that he was driving slowly. You know how? What do you mean by that?
I mean, there was no sense of urgency. He, even if a carjacking is somebody speeding off of your car, that was not the case. He just pulled out, waved to the back. And at that point, I realized he was going the wrong way and that he was going to have to pass me again to exit, and that's when I proceeded to run to the
ground. And what about the pullout when he actually finally pulled out of the parking lot onto the street? Do you recall that portion?
There was, as you recall, he was didn't seem like he was in a hurry to get anywhere.
He did or did not. Now, with regard to your friend who struggled with mental health, you said that you told, I guess, the police that your friend had paranoia and schizophrenia. But I guess, are you saying today that you don't exactly know if that is the diagnosis?
I am not a doctor and I have not seen any documentation that that is his actual diagnosis. That is something that was discussed amongst the two of us. So it was an understanding that that is what he was going through.
Okay, sure. And then, so you would see your friend, I guess, while he was on medication and also while he was off medication.
Correct.
I guess, so you're saying you saw moments when he was off or in acting, it seeming like there was something not acting as he should be.
Correct.
And you are saying that was kind of similar to your interaction with Mr. Rocky?
Yes.
I think you described a scenario when we discussed earlier today. Do you remember talking about a scenario of what was it was like with your friend having a conversation with him?
I think we discussed with that particular friend, you'd be in a dinner situation or in a conversation and you weren't really sure if they were listening or paying attention, and you kind of was like, hey, like, am I talking to you right now? Are you here with me? Like, that was
okay, would you have to, I guess, get that friend to come back to understanding, you know, what you were doing or talking about?
Sometimes you would have to just kind of reiterate the conversation.
Okay, to get them to snap back into where it is?
Right.
Okay.
Like his focus was somewhere else.
Okay.
Whether it was over here listening to something else in the restaurant or over here, just not focusing. The inability.
Okay. Now, when you say that Mr. Reinking was kind of, I guess, not focused on what you were talking about demoing the car, well, was there a point where he kind of snapped back into it and understood clearly what he was doing as far as you could tell? demanding the car key from him?
No, he was very direct about what he wanted to happen.
Okay. Was he checked out as he was telling him to get out of the car? Okay.
That's
all I got. All right. Understood. So, did Mr. Bruno asked you, said there were moments of clarity. He asked you about moments of clarity and moments of not. I guess at that point, would you say that was a moment of clarity for Mr. Ryan?
I believe so. I believe I also stated that I felt like if I had been less confrontational or inquisitive, maybe he would have left with me in the vehicle. I think because I kind of resisted letting go of the key right away, I was a little bit more defiant. He was very direct, and he wanted me out of the vehicle.
All right.
And, Your Honor, the state would ask that the video and the an original copy of the transcript of the name and the cumulative of the next evidence. So,
Detective, could you please state your name for the record?
Desmond Sumrall.
And you have previously testified in this trial. I am specifically going to ask you about April 23rd of 2018.
Yes, ma'am.
In your previous testimony, you described a time where you were at South Precinct when Mr. Reinking arrived at that location. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
And for procedural reasons, I was not able to ask you about this before, but what was the purpose of having Mr. Reinking transported to South Precinct that day?
So I could attempt to interview him.
And did you attempt to interview him?
I did.
And I guess, was that recorded?
It was.
And who were you with when you attempted to interview Mr. Reinking?
So myself and Detective Phil Clare.
And Detective, you've already said that that was recorded. We have the recording queued up as well as I have it on a disc. I would ask that the disc be made the next numbered exhibit.
Your second objection was earlier when we had the recess.
I don't know what the problem is.
It's why we were addressing the incident.
Come on.